Inside the world's most advanced aircraft carrier, life in the middle of the ocean. Hello there, everyone, and as always, welcome back to the channel. Aircraft carriers are critical components of every nation's attacking and defense strategies. Air power has always been a critical component of every country's national security strategy. The Gerald Ford class carrier is powered by two nuclear reactors and weighs over 100,000 tons when fully loaded, making it the largest warship ever built. The total cost of construction is estimated to be around $17 billion, with $5 billion spent only on research. It came in at 22% over budget after multiple delays. Building began in 2009 and was finished and delivered to the Navy in late 2017. Following the formal launching of the ship, during construction time, Gerald Ford passed away. Ford was never able to witness the finished result, despite the fact that the naming was already in place. Of course, the ship's principal function is to serve as a launch pad for those 75 acres. When aircraft are not on deck or on missions, they are stored inside INSITE's massive hangar. There's also a plethora of armament, as well as several large lifts for transporting everything from storage to the aircraft. Prepared to take up arms, you may have seen films of military aircraft taking off and landing from aircraft carriers, and you may be familiar with them. Although the Gerald Ford's deck is the longest available to these daring pilots, they must still land their planes in just around 1,100 feet of runway. Alternatively, there could be a dramatic overhanging drop-off into the ocean. Officers set up the high-paced catapult-aided takeoffs in the tower, and powerful computers assist in the placement of aircraft on the deck, all from a bubble, formerly an integrated catapult control system. Because of technological advancements, the Gerald can launch 25% more aircraft per day with 25% fewer crew members than the previous Nimitz-class carrier. In the long run, it is believed that the lower crew numbers will help offset the new ship's high cost. The electromagnetic launch device developed by Ford is also lighter, takes up less space, and requires less maintenance than previous steam-powered catapults. The reduced strain is expected to benefit the aircraft themselves, and technical adjustments mean more different types of aircraft can be launched. The technology has caused some building delays and continues to do so. According to Navy officers, Admiral John Greener, Chief of Naval Operations, is definitely a technological marvel. She will carry unmanned craft joint strike fighters, and once planes land, she will deploy lasers. There are more than 40 different fueling stations to assist in getting planes back off the deck. The officers can still use traditional methods. The sailors collect autographs of famous guests, including presidents, on currency, using the Ouija board model in the fourth case. A heritage safety mechanism is provided on the side of the deck for dumping any weapons that may be misfired. After a weapon malfunctions in the 1960s that resulted in a fire and deaths of over 100 people across the USS Forrestal. Of course, the various types of aircraft aren't the only weaponry available to the carrier. To protect its own decks, the ship has several CC Barrows, short-range anti-aircraft and anti-missile weapons. RAM weapons, which are lightweight surface-to-air choices that can be moved around the deck, are also included in the design. The bridge, of course, is the main control center from which the massive ship's twin nuclear engines can drive it to speeds of over 30 knots. It takes a long time to stop at 100,000 tons, as you may imagine. The Ford has a lot of military equipment, but it's also meant to provide a reasonable amount of comfort for the thousands of people who may be stationed there for extended periods of time. The Ford is a cutting-edge character. Gender-neutral toilets, on the other hand, have been around for a long time. While the majority of persons on board are usually guys, knowing your rhinos on the entire ship is essential. However, the explanation is not political, but rather practical. Because there's no berthing facilities designated to one sex or the other operational specialists, this is supposed to provide the ship flexibility. Kalia Matson Butcher, First Class, Old Navy Time, Other modern features include USB ports for phone charging, energy-efficient light bulbs, fewer passengers per cabin, large exercise rooms, and superior air conditioning when compared to other Navy structures. The logistics of an aircraft carrier can be very complex to grasp. However, this extends far beyond military capacities and capabilities of these vessels. For instance, with up to 3,000 personnel on board the ship, feeding the crew 3 square meals a day is an undertaking on its own. Right, it's worth noting that mealtime is no longer only a massive cafeteria affair. There are also multiple galleys making everything from spare ribs to soup to cookies and cakes around the clock. The mammoth vessels are often referred to as flu, with thousands of its residents working around the clock to make sure the vessels stay afloat. The wide range of selected categories on these spacecraft astonishes the majority of individuals. Many of them are similar to what they would find on land, such as a Starbucks, which I suppose benefits sailors by providing them a sense of home. Starbucks isn't commonly found on ships, particularly battleships. A basic store, a laundry, a dry cleaning and uniform shop, a barber shop, and a post office are all available at most carriers. There is also an emergency room, a dental clinic, and an in-house laboratory where results could be checked. Because carriers spend up to 9 months away from their home port, it is critical that they do everything they can to meet the needs and desires of crew and officers. One of the reasons for this self-sufficiency is that the navies all over the world can understand how stressful both operational operations and routine patrols can be. When new crew members are about to cross the equator for the first time, this is where they should go. The rules vary each ship, but they are always part of a larger ceremony overseen by the crew leaders, which usually includes costumes, plays, and various expensive equipment. A swim call is what is referred to as ritual. Officers will often demand that sailors leap from different angles when they are instructed to explore undiscovered waters by jumping into the ocean for a nice long swim. It's a chance for them to show their mettle in front of their peers, with bonus points for cannonballs and dives. At the end of the day, everyone gets a nice break from work and boosts camaraderie. The sailors are to blame. This video has come to an end. I hope you found it interesting. Subscribing to this channel is a must. As a result, you will not miss any of our new stuff. Next time, we will see you.